keeping this in mind, let's go back and look at our pressure diffusivity equation again. That now our pressure is going to be a function of x and y, whereas before it was just a function of x. Well, I guess before we even do that, we'll just make it a function of an x vector in 3 space, so x, y, and z, right, equal to the divergence of some tensor valued k, p at x. Right. And just like we've done before, we're going to multiply by an arbitrary function and integrate over the domain. And at this point is where we'll make the decision that the pressure is two-dimensional, right? So now we'll say the pressure is two-dimensional, so it's only a function of x and y. Therefore, our volume integral of the domain can be split into what I'll say is the domain over the depth of the reservoir, right, over the depth of the reservoir. Now our W becomes a function of x and y. At least this one time I'll write out all the functional dependences, so phi is also a function of x and y. Potentially ct is too, we're not going to consider that case. P is a function of x and y. I'll go ahead and move over this to the one side of the equation here. Still have the divergence of k mu p. Now the integral is over the z direction, which is just the depth times the area, okay, dA. And because the depth is going to be constant for any x and y, then we're just going to, this inner integral integrates to a constant, so then we'll just have now d of x and y, where d is the depth of the reservoir. Depth. We have that. Now, at this point, I'm going to go ahead and introduce my discretization, just like we've done before. This time we're going to discretize over rectangles. And so what we're going to do is just split up our domain integral into two integrals, one over the x and y direction, the x direction being the length of the reservoir, the y direction being the height of the reservoir, if you will. And so then what we'll have is the summation from I equals 0 to nx minus 1, summation j equals 0 to n y minus 1, all of that integrated. Now, Now what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and write out the divergence symbol, right? So this is an operator, right? The divergence operator. I'm going to go ahead and write out what that'll be, right? So it's partial x times this guy. Plus partial y times that same thing. I'm going to leave off the functional dependence on this p to give myself room here to close the integral. It's integrated over dx dy, and that's equal to 0. Now we're going to do our integration by parts step on this second term here. So the first term will remain unchanged, although that's enclosed in the summation as well. So the first term will remain unchanged, and we'll go ahead and carry out an integration by parts on this second term. And I'll go to a new page to do that. So then we have the boundary terms that the integration by parts generate. So I know that's one big long equation, but that's what we have. So just like we've done before, we're going to let the function w of xy equal to 1 and use midpoint quadrature on the integrals. So when we use midpoint quadrature on these two volume integrals here, we're going to end up with essentially a function d of x that's evaluated at the midpoint. So xij, right? So they're going to be evaluated at the midpoint where this has a constant depth. Okay, so the depth is constant over the discrete area evaluated at the midpoint. Therefore, when we take a derivative of it, that's going to go to 0. And so these terms here are going to vanish due to the nature of the midpoint integration. So those are going to vanish, the midpoint integration. And then, you know, this is 1, this is 1, this is 1. And then we'll write down what we have left over. At the same time, I'm going to go ahead and use a forward difference approximation for grad p, keeping in mind that anytime we have an evaluation point at the center, at the ij, at the center of the grid block, then the derivative is going to be 0, right? So we only have, again, if we have an evaluation for the pressure, the grad p at the center of the ij or the I or j point, then that term will be 0. The only place where we actually have a derivative in the pressure is along the edges, right? So at the xi plus delta xi over 2, and likewise yj plus yj j over 2. And similarly for the minus, you know, yj minus delta yj over 2 xj minus delta xi over 2, which would be xi. So it's only along the boundaries that we actually have a change in pressure. And so when we compute the gradient, there's always going to be one term, right? Remember, the gradient is a vector, right? So grad p is like partial p partial x partial p partial y. But one of these at the center point, whether we're evaluating it xi or yj, if it's evaluated at the center point, then one of those terms is going to be zero. Okay. So with all that, we'll go ahead and write down the discrete equations using the four difference approximation and evaluating the integrals with midpoint quadrature. We'll also divide the whole equation by the formation volume factor, like we did for the 1D case. You know what? I think I'm going to go ahead and introduce our shorthand notation. Just like we had previously, if we have xi, then we're just going to use an I. And we have yj, we'll use comma j, like that. Likewise, for the pressure gradient, we have I comma j. From using the midpoint quadrature on this first term, we have delta xi, delta yj. D I plus a half. So we have that. So now if we identify some terms like we have done previously, that bi comma j is equal to where vi comma j is equal to di comma j times delta xi delta yj, right? So the depth times the length in the x direction times the length in the y direction, that gives you the volume of that cell. This is the transmissibility in the x direction here at the right side of the cell. Transmissibility also in the x direction at the left side of a cell. The transmissibility in the y direction. You can always tell the left from the right by where the, I'm sorry, you can always tell the if it's in the x direction or the y direction by where the half indice is on the I or the J, and the left or the right, the right is positive, the left is negative, the top is positive, and the bottom is negative. So with those definitions, we can write that equation more compactly. So now we have this equation, and just like we've done before, we'll go ahead and write out, start expanding our summation. Now, there's just too many terms to even come close to writing out very much of it, but I'll write out a little bit to try to illustrate what we're going to do next. And I think I'll just stop there. Because expanding all those t terms out would take quite a while. But at this point, let's recall that we had a mapping between our grid number, our grid block system, and our IJ system. So let's recall that we have this L equals to J times NX plus I, right? And so if we plug in any ij up here, then we get the corresponding grid number. So for example, this is 0, 0. If we plug in 0, 0, then we get that L is equal to 1, right? So in other words, B 0, 0 is B L equal to 0. And likewise, P 0, 0 is P L equals to 0, and B 1 0 is B L equals to 1, P 1 0 is P L equals to 1, and so on. And so if we use this renumbering to rewrite this equation one more time, so now we have B I'll leave the transmissibilities and the IJ indices because it's easy to tell. In other words, what side of the of any given cell, right? So if this is the L equals zero cell, the t to the 1/2 would be the transmissibility in this direction, right? But then now that is PL equal to 0 minus PL equal to 1. And there'll be some more terms. Then when you have transmissibility in the y direction, so if you have 0, 1/2, for example, then now we have PL equals 0 minus PL equal to NX. This should be clear if we have a simple example like this, right? L equals 1, L equals 2, so in this case NX is 3. So the transmissibility that this describes is at the 0, 1/2, so it's in this way, and that goes between the L equals 0 grid block and the L equals NX, which in this case is 3, right? The grid number is L equals 3, and that is also NX, right? And so on. And so you ought to be able to see that just like before, we have some diagonal B matrix. And now the total length is nx times ny. Right. It's a total number of grid blocks, nx times ny. All of that multiplying of vector p. Right. Plus, I'm just going to write right now a T matrix, right, times P, and that's going to be equal to Q vector, right? Which, until we apply boundary conditions, will just be a vector of zeros, right? But let's go ahead and look at what T is in this case, right? I need it, the reason I wrote it as just a block matrix here is because I need more room to write out the terms. And basically, that blocks matrix T is going to have the form T to the minus 1/2 0 plus T to the 1/2 0 plus T to the 0 minus 1/2 T 0 plus T 0 1/2. So that's one column. And before I fill in the other one, just to make sure my spacing is correct, and I'll go ahead and write the next one here, right? So this is now T to the 1/2 0 plus T to the 3/2 0 plus T 0 to the minus 1/2 plus T 0 to the 1/2. And then what goes all in these columns, right, of course, just like before, is minus T to the 1/2 0. And then there's going to be separated several columns of zeros. Right, so 0, 0. And then there will be minus T zero, 1/2, right? Zero. And the distance, you know, so how many zeros are in between? So the distance between the diagonal and this term is going to be nx, right? Because this transmissibility has to do with the value coming from above, right? And so then T to the 1/2 0 minus T 0 1/2 and so on, right? So in the end, T matrix is going to be a pentadiagonal matrix, right? It's going to be a pentadiagonal matrix that has a full diagonal entry, full off diagonal entries, and then entries out here where this is nx apart, right? And of course, you have to come up with the logic to fill this all in. Then when you discretize in time, that is, you know,